We're here at Fully Charged and we're here at Electrifying America. And Electrifying America is an example that really a good, never spoil a good crisis. Because out of Dieselgate came this investment from Volkswagen into the electrification of America. And Wayne, you started Electric America and you were employee
number four. What did 75 employees now.
And 75 employees. And what did you do before Electrifying America?
So I was minding my own business at Audi, doing product planning for future electric portfolio. I was looking after diesel and, frankly, all of our kind of new technologies.
Yeah. So the e-tron was your baby?
That came from my team, yes.
Okay. How are you happy? How satisfied are you?
It turned out, of course, you could always do better.
The next version will be backed,
but it was proud to be the first full long-range EV and an SUV to boot, which we needed another SUV at the time.
And you learned a lot from it.
We absolutely did, and we're selling a lot, and now we have a charging network to support it.
And then the shock of the system came, Dieselgate. How was it to be inside Volkswagen when that happened?
It was hard for all of us, I think, personally and professionally. But we also knew, okay, it was a tragic mistake, but now...
Did you believe it? How long did it take you to believe such a... I mean, you couldn't come up with a story like that, right? If somebody would come up with a theater play, you would say that's unrealistic.
Well, by that time, I think the evidence was pretty clear, and it was time to accept it and move on. And what was the best way to move on? And there were a lot of discussions at very high levels that obviously I was not privy to, but one part that I did get involved with was a $2 billion investment out of the total.
Which of how much was the total fines?
It's north of $25 billion today.
Okay. So Volkswagen is so powerful that they can basically pay a fine of $25 billion and invest $2 billion in a very useful way, Electrifying America.
But of course, that wasn't easy.
No. Still they survived and they're thriving and they're doing really good.
The rest of the fines, of course, were to buy back cars, to repair vehicles, to help the states with NOx mitigation caused by the diesel. But this was the one I think that was most
positive
to me was let's help accelerate the ZEV adoption movement. There were not enough cars and clearly the big problem was not enough charging. And so I really believed in it, not only at the Volkswagen Group companies, but ZEV adoption in general in the U.S. needed a catalyst.
Okay, and then we have Electrifying America. And you now have a bunch of chargers, right? How many spots do you have and how many charging poles?
So I was at our grand opening in May of 2018 in Chicopee, Massachusetts, site number one. Next week, we will surpass 400 sites and a total of about 1,700 chargers at those sites. So it's been the quickest deployment of DC fast charging in history. It's also the most powerful open network today in the U.S., and we're just getting warmed up.
Yeah. And what's the power of the chargers?
So our chargers will go from 150 to 350 kilowatts of speed. The Porsche Taycan will take 270. The Harley Davidson right next door will take 25 kilowatts. We don't discriminate. Whatever power you need, we can supply. Yeah. And it's really future-proof. And I think, especially with 350 kilowatts now, manufacturers can bring new high-power EVs long-range to market and enjoy this network and not have to worry about their customers charging a long time.
Okay, and how is it allocated? Is it only California and a little bit Texas, or are you going coast to coast?
So our commitment is 40% California, 60% to EPA states. That was the consent decree. But beyond that, it's a data-driven process. Where are the future EVs going to be? Where are they today? So we're placed in the prominent metros and along highways in 40 states, including DC. So close to 400 stations now. We'll be at close to 800 stations by the end of 21 and over 3,500 chargers.
2025? Grand plan?
We haven't come up with those plans, but we're going to keep to build, obviously, and we're going to cover more areas, but the focus will continue to be DC fast charging.
How many do you need to have a good coverage in the state? Do we need 20,000 stations?
Well, I would tell you it's probably closer to that. Our $2 billion investment is a great start, but we need more public and private investment at all levels to make this work. It doesn't have to copy the gas station model because you have home charging, of course, but we're going to need more than what we're doing.
How's the charging model work and what kind of options do I have as a user?
So it's really easy. We kind of joke that our chargers accept everything but cash. You can download our app and pay as you go with a credit card, or you can pay digitally in a subscription. We have 20% discount there. And several car companies that we're working with, including Harley-Davidson here, includes charging when you buy or purchase or lease the vehicle.
And then you can use it unlimited, or is it then a certain price? It
depends. There's unlimited plants, there's fixed energy bundles, but in all cases, the energy cost is below the equivalent cost of gasoline, because we think a major impediment is concern about what does it cost to fuel these vehicles. It's very economical.
Yeah, it should be. I mean, we have in Germany system, and they charge Ionity, they now have 79 cents per kilowatt hour, which makes it almost as expensive as driving gasoline. But of course, you can, with the right card, you can get it for half the cost or that kind of stuff.
Right.
When do you need to be break even with Electrifying America so that you can expand?
Well, ideally before the 10th year of our commitment, of course, because at that point you have to really understand what is the go forward path. And obviously, at least recovering your costs is critical to sustaining the investment. So I'm confident we'll be there before then. We have fair and reasonable pricing. We constantly look at our deployment costs and operational improvements to reduce where we can. So I'm confident we'll get there, even though a lot of stations or companies today have struggled to be profitable in the charging business.
Do you already have profitable stations?
Yes, we do. Actually, some high utilization stations, but I think we need a few more years with a lot more EVs on the road, and they are coming, before we get to the utilization that we need to be at.
We know that California is the only state, is the beautiful green state. Is there any other state, two or other three states, where you see things coming up?
Absolutely. Well, the Northeast states, especially the states that adopt the ZEV mandate.
New York?
Yes. New York and north of that, New Jersey. They've all got progressive policies. The utilities are easy to work with. Lots of other incentives to move up. Colorado, Denver, just passed an incentive as well to become part of the ZEV state initiative. So I think the cars are coming, independent of the fuel economy standards going on at the federal level.
What is hardest, to get the spots, to get the energy companies to comply, or what is the most difficult in expanding?
There's obviously more than one challenge, but what we've learned in putting down nearly 400 sites is that, and this is the most complex infrastructure project you could ever do, even with the things you can control, you have things like permits from the local jurisdiction, which are supposed to take a couple of weeks, can take 6 months or more. Utilities are great when you set up a factory or an office building, but when you need a charging site energized in 6 weeks or less, it's difficult. So we need things to move a little faster. I think some of the utilities could have more favorable rates for EV charging and not assessing demand charges, which is a huge penalty for us that we can't pass on to the customer.
Do you already have places where you have batteries to basically do the charging?
We do. 125 of our sites today are slated for battery storage, and they're there to reduce the load on the grid to avoid that demand peak charge, which is so considerable. In the future, we look to these same batteries providing power back to the grid when it's needed.
When is your $2 billion investment? When is it used?
So it'll come to a conclusion in December of 26th. So January of 27, the consent decree is complete. We will be a large, profitable, I hope, charging company, and we're going to keep doing what we're doing.
So that is Electrifying America. Good things come out of a crisis, and they're building a big network. Takes them a little while to catch up with Tesla, but they're working hard on it. Thank you.
Thank you.